Hey guys, today we're going to talk about the Rolex Milgauss, probably the most overlooked Rolex model out there. Does the Rolex Milgauss deserve more love? Who is it for and what are your options? Today we will break down the Milgauss for you. And here's our man from New York. Hello, Thomas. What's going on in Manhattan?
Hey, Pascal. It's another beautiful day in the city. Sun is shining, trees are blooming, and we're happy to be talking about some watches.
One last question, Thomas, before we talk about the Milgauss. What's on your wrist today?
Well, since we're talking about a rather eccentric Rolex today, I brought an eccentric watch of my own. This is the 1950s Benrus Dial-O-Rama Jump Hour Watch. A very old, very cool, and very fragile piece. What about you today? What do you got on?
My watch of the day is the AP Royal Oak 15450ST, the 37 millimeter with the silver dial. Thought it's a great day to wear this one.
There we go. Always a good day for Royal Oak.
Thomas, tell me, what the hell was Rolex thinking when they released the Milgauss in 56? Who is it for?
So as you mentioned, Pascal, this is not your typical stainless steel sport Rolex. A lot of the ones that we've seen in the brand's history were made for divers, explorers, race car drivers, airline pilots. This watch, the Rolex Milgauss, was actually made for scientists. The construction of it is meant to be very anti-magnetic, and that actually influences the design cues as well. So this is a watch for a certain kind of professional, different than what you'd see in a lot of the other lineup today.
Yeah, right. With the Rolex Milgauss, it seems like Rolex wanted to cover a different niche. They wanted to get the physicists and scientists covered. So they released this model in 56, actually, with the reference 6543, which was kind of a prototype. And approximately 1 year later, they came up with the 6541, which actually look pretty much like the sub, don't you think?
They do, yes. It was a really popular style at the time. So the 6543s actually came before the 6541, as you mentioned. The serial number or the reference numbers were a little mixed up compared to what we're used to. The 43s are really hard to find, and as you can imagine, very expensive. But I really love the design cues of that area that they took from the Rolex subs. A lot of people will compare them to what we call the James Bond Rolex, the 6538, which you can see in Dr. No. It's got the red triangle at the top. You got a honeycomb dial, really sharp indices. You got some bezel action there and the signature lightning bolt hand.
So the Milgauss was definitely built for scientists and professionals using the principle of the Faraday cage, right? And with this, they tried to solve the issue of anti-magnetic fields. But what's the problem with these anti-magnetic fields? Does it harm the watch, or what was the reason?
So the reason why this came about is there were scientists and other people in scientific fields that were around these heavy magnetic fields all day. So the problem for them was either their watch would be, the timing would be thrown off, or they wouldn't be able to wear a watch at all. As you know, the mechanics inside a watch, the movement is very susceptible to magnetic fields, especially for precise timing. So Rolex needed a watch that had this Faraday cage to keep that interference out and keep time running precisely.
So with this Rolex model, we have the function already in its name, mil and 4000 and Gauss. And that means that the watch is, or the first watch was resistant to 1000 and Gauss, which pretty much sums the function up, or the special feature of the watch, I think. What's different to other models like the Submariner or the Explorer or even the GMT is that with the Milgauss, we don't have too many models. If you search for Milgauss on Chrono 24, for example, you don't find too many different models. So let's maybe quickly sum up the different references available. So I mentioned the 6541 or the 6543, which was the first model. What comes next?
Sure, so the 6541 and 6543, the original kind of prototype and first release of this watch, as you mentioned, are very hard to find. And when you do, they are a pretty penny on the market. From there, Rolex released the 1019 in the 60s. So that one's a little bit different. It's got a different dial color in black and silver. They actually did away with the lightning bolt hand by and large, replacing it with a straight seconds hand with a red triangle in the end. The bezel is no more, it's smooth now. Our industries are a little bit different and the hands are a little bit different as well. So they really did a remake of this model and it actually didn't sell too well at the time. So much so that they actually discontinued the model in 1998 for almost 20 years.
With the current version with the reference 1164-00, we have several dial options. We have the white dial with orange markers and the special hand, the black dial and the black dial with the greenish sapphire crystal, the GC. And we have introduced in 2014, the electric blue dial. But other than that, what are the biggest changes for this model compared to the 1019?
So the biggest changes are going to be in the sizing, the case, the movement, and the design elements like you touched on. So we have a modern case sizing at 40 millimeters, moved up from the 38 with the 1019. Case-wise, we're looking at a mix of polished and brushed surfaces. The new ones especially are highly polished. The movement-wise, they actually released a new caliber, the 3131. It has the same Faraday cage that you'd expect from a Mildias, but this one also has a parachrome hairspring and a nickel phosphorus escapement for added shock resistance and anti-magnetism there. Otherwise, you're looking at the design features with that electric orange lightning hand, other orange accents in there, and the special dial colors. Let's also talk about the glass vert real quick, which is the green tinted sapphire crystal. This is really just a design feature unique to this watch. Rolex just wanted to see if they could do it just to do it. And they actually don't have a patent on this because they consider it too hard to recreate.
That's very self-confident from Rolex, but typical for Rolex as well.
Very confident.
What's attracting my eye is also the Oyster bracelet, because what's special about the Oyster here is that it has a brushed and a polished part, so elegant and sporty at once. That's something we don't see for other models like the Explorer or the Oyster Perpetual. So due to the functions and the protection of the movement, the watch is thicker. It's 13.5 millimeter in height, whereas most day just are 12 millimeter. And I think you definitely see that, that it's chunkier or more chunky.
Yeah, so the watch is a little thicker and it also has more polished surfaces. So it's a little likely to get banged up a little bit more, but with the movement protections there, internally, you're not gonna really see any damage. It's more shock resistant than a sub, a little thicker than a sub, which makes the watch unique in addition to all the design features here.
And the size is 40 millimeter instead of the 38 for the 1019. But I think in the metal, it does not really look like a 40. For me, it looks much bigger, I have to say. Maybe it's also the thickness.
So with the diameter of 40 millimeters and a slightly elongated lug to lug of 49, it does have a little bit of wrist presence, especially with that 13.5 millimeters. But a surprising thing is, even though it has the Faraday cage, the soft iron core in the watch, it's actually the same weight as the sub. So with your eyes closed, you wouldn't really know that you're dealing with a more robust timepiece on the wrist.
As you mentioned, Thomas, in the beginning, that the 6541 especially is pretty expensive. If you check Chrono24 for this reference, it costs about 345K. There are fewer offers available only, because it is said that they only did 200 of this reference. So it's pretty rare. The 1019 goes for around 30K. And the latest version, the 1164-00, depending on the dial you want to pick, it's 9 to 12K roughly. There are also different offers available, of course, on Chrono24. And what about the price development? So is it the typical Rolex price development increase? What can you tell me about the invest character of this watch?
You know, I would say a rising tide raises all ships. So Rolex across the board is going up. I always tell clients, as soon as you buy a Rolex, you're making money. And that's the same for this watch as well. We've seen the most dramatic price increase for the 116-400 GV. That's the anniversary edition with the blue dial and that green tinted sapphire. But even with that increasing curve, you're still getting a pretty good deal on a steel sport Rolex. So at 40 millimeters, you can still pay between 9 and 12, which in Rolex terms is not a whole lot of money inflation wise. So this could potentially be a good investment for the future just because prices are low now and they're only going up.
Of course, you can check out the price developments for each reference in our watch collection. We will post a link in the description below. If you ask watch guys or a friend of yours what Rolex they currently fancy or would love to buy next, I think my experience is that the chance is not too high that they will mention the Milgauss. So it's a bit overlooked, I have the feeling. What's your experience?
You know, you're right, Pascal. We do not get a lot of calls about this watch here at Corona 24. I think that's due to a few factors. The Milgauss is a little on the chunky side for a Rolex. It's highly polished, so it might not age quite as well as some others. You also have a lot of competition at this price point, and not to mention the design cues with the bright colors, the lightning bolt hands, the blue dials, the orange accents. It's not everybody's cup of tea.
My biggest concern with the Milgauss is that it's somewhere in between the Explorer and the Oyster Perpetual from its looks, because it's sporty and functional, but it does also want to be more elegant, because you see it on the bracelet, I think, with the brushed and polished parts. So it's like in the middle. It's a mix. It's sporty and elegant, and that makes it, I think, hard to position, because if you want an elegant watch, you could pick the Datejust, for example. If you want a sporty watch, you maybe go for the Explorer, which is also pricier than the Milgauss. So I think the problem with the Milgauss is to tell what does it want to be. And that's the biggest concern. I think it's a bit overpriced for what it is. But yeah, that's maybe just my point of view. I don't know if you agree.
But I think with that in mind, Pascal, the Milgauss is still a relatively reasonably priced Rolex, especially at a stainless steel in 40 millimeters. And I think the cons that we mentioned before could actually be positives in a certain light. So because this watch is often overlooked for a variety of factors, it's not a watch that you see on people's wrists that often. It's not a watch you see on Instagram, and the prices are still relatively low. So if Rolex were to discontinue this at some point, then you add in the hype, then you add in the scarcity, you add in the whole herd mentality of people really focusing a lot of eyes on this. And it could be one where you buy it before it really shoots up in price.
You already mentioned that the popularity could change due to the fact that there are rumors that Milgauss will be discontinued very soon. And that's a very interesting point we should talk about.
Yeah, you know, we did see rumors online about this watch potentially getting discontinued at Watches and Wonders 2021. I think you see that anytime there is an underperforming, potentially overpriced or overlooked model. I think that represents a couple opportunities both for Rolex and for collectors. For collectors, it could be good if you already have a Rolex Milgauss and they discontinue it. You get the benefits of additional hype and attention and the scarcity. So there's fewer of those on the market, people who hadn't considered one before, and now that it's running out, you know, maybe they'll grab one now before prices shoot up. For Rolex, I think it would be good, not only because it would help them sell their current inventory, but I think it would also be a good watch to reissue, you know, a few years down the line, perhaps with more of an old school kind of color scheme, like you see in the Sitz 543, give it the BB58 treatment, give it a more, you know, classic sizing, classic color scheme, still with that individual design detail, and kind of boost up the appeal around this model that a lot of people just don't talk about.
If you don't like the style of the current Milgauss, and they will not bring a new one that you might like, what other options do you have if you still want to have this pretty simple design of a three-hander? And the function that it's anti-magnetic or shock resistant, what alternatives do you have? Are there some watches you would recommend?
You know, I think Like we talked about earlier, the anti-magnetism and the shock resistance, Rolex does a pretty good job with that already in their current lineup. So a lot of times what you'll see is this watch compared to the Oyster Perpetual versus the Mille Douce. One is a little more conventional, one is a little more eccentric. And so people kind of draw the line there as far as what they're looking for. So if the Mille Douce is not really your cup of tea, but you still want the protections of a Rolex, you still want the build quality of a Rolex, I would look more at the Oyster Perpetual model in full, or some of the similarly priced Explorer models or other sport Rolexes there to get more of a classic, more recognizable Rolex, but still have that build quality there.
The Oyster Perpetual and the Explorer are definitely alternatives within the Rolex family, but I think if you don't want to stay in the Rolex family at all, there are other options like IWC Engineer or the Aquaterra, of course. Or if you don't like any of these pieces or with this style, Thomas, we have a giveaway running, right?
So if you like watches and you like free money, subscribe to our channel and check out the video description below for the full details on how to enter. We're giving away $10,000 towards the purchase of your dream watch. And with that, Pascal, thanks for having me. It's always a pleasure to talk to you.
Thanks, Thomas. Thank you, guys. See you soon and enjoy your watches.